Okay, let's start. First of all, it's my pleasure to have Susanna Häkkilä, who's here as a speaker. At least for us, we always enjoy your papers in our journals. Susanna started her career or her education in Brazil at the University of Rio de Janeiro, where she did her bachelor's in biology in 1992. Then she went to the US to the Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio, to pursue a master's in neuroscience with Story Lattice. Afterwards, she went to France and to Germany to do her PhD at the University of Paris 6 with Yves Lemoine. And also in Germany with Paul Singer, that probably some of you know, at least don't know. After this, she came here, so she got a PhD. She also stayed on for a year for postdoc. And then in 2002, she got a position in Brazil at the University of Rio de Janeiro. And there she conceived the idea of why did no one count the neurons of brains yet. So she stumbled upon this number of that the human brain has 100 billion cells, and she couldn't find the source. Where does this number actually come from? And with this idea to actually count the number of cells, she got her own lab and it was really very successful. And now she's here to talk more about numbers of cells in different species, about how they correlate with, like, how size is a factor, or is not a factor, on how many brain cells you have, and also how this determines your cognitive abilities. Thanks for coming.
Thank you so much for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here. I am very fond of talking to audiences of students only. Gunthrop, I'll consider you a student as well. Let me just fill in a little bit more what Helen was telling you, because the word graduate students, and this is an unorthodox meeting, and I have a very unorthodox background. So let me tell you this first. What you're doing today does not necessarily have anything to do with what you will be doing in maybe 10 years. And that is a really good thing, or at least I think, because that happened to me. So quick background. I started as an undergrad in a plant biology lab. Then I moved to a virology lab, and that's where I spent 2.5 years of my bachelor's degree. From there, I left to Cleveland to start graduate school, which I thought was going to give me a degree in developmental genetics, working with Drosophila. But turned out that when I got officially accepted into the program, they had this requirement that I first rotated at least 3 different labs, and I was just, oh, come on, I know what I want to do, just let me do it already. So I rotated first in 2 labs that were Drosophila developmental genetics labs. And then a friend of mine asked if he could try to talk me into neuroscience, which he thought was really cool. And I knew exactly 0 about, because they skipped that part in my undergrad, the part where brains, animals come with brains and that serve some function. So I started my 3rd rotation in a neuroscience lab that was Story Lattice, and I never left. I mean, I did leave her lab, but neuroscience turned out to me to be fascinating because it was something that just went on even after I stepped out the lab door. The questions are unending. So I started out working in the development of the peripheral nervous system. Then I started taking classes at Case. That was a really good place to be because the classes were amazing. And I discovered that systems neurophysiology was the coolest thing. That was what I wanted to do when I grew up. And it so happened that there was an opportunity for me to join Bo Singer's lab. So I left Case with a master's degree and joined his lab and was there for the next 4 years. So my degree is, I am, I guess you could say, I'm officially a systems neurophysiologist. But what happened was that when I was done with the experimental work and writing my thesis, they had this custom at the Max Planck in Frankfurt of when you were done with your thesis work, you were welcome to just spend the next few months in the library. And it turned out that the library of the MPI in Frankfurt was amazing because that was one of the first, if not the first, Department of Neurology in Germany, I believe. So they had these really cool books from the 19th century, from the early 20th century, and I got used to reading through the original literature. So I learned a number of the sources, and I learned a number of the first players, let's say, in the field that I was interested in. And that came in really handy because when I finished there, the natural thing to do would, of course, be to just take a PhD in what I was doing, naturally. And I remember at the time considering, well, I guess I should go to David McCormick's lab. I should just go work with somebody who is doing neurophysiology as well. But I was having so much fun reading about all these different things in neuroscience, reading all different sorts of papers. And I knew that if I went into a traditional postdoc, I would have to become the super specialist in this little part of the universe. And it just seemed so much more interesting to find something that would give me the opportunity to have to read for work. And so I got a position at a museum in Museum of Life in Brazil, where I worked for 3 years. I was a science communicator for 3 years. And that was really cool. I can tell you more about that. But then what happened that got me here was that one of the first things I wanted to know about the public was let me just get this started so the timer works here. One of the first things I wanted to do for the public was figure out what people already knew about brains or thought they knew about brains or actually didn't have any idea or knew wrong. So I ran a quiz, a series of very short statements about brains with the general public. Things like, and there were some really interesting and really positive results, like 80% of all people believed that the mind results from the workings of the brain. That's pretty cool, right? Or that if the brain stops working, you lose consciousness. Also quite good. But it turned out that 60% of college-educated people in Rio believed that they carried 90% of that weight in their brains. They believed, they said yes to the statement, we only use 10% of our brain. Which was quite striking. I knew that was a thing, but that was what got me started looking into it. So 3 years later, I got a position at the university, officially to keep working in science communication, but the hiring committee saw my CV and they said, well, we know you have a strong background in science and doing research, and you seem to enjoy it very much. So if you want to go back to doing research here, that will not be frowned upon. I was like, all right, sure, thank you. I'll think about that. And so that's what got me started. And I think the unorthodoxy in it was incredibly helpful in this particular case, because what that meant was that when I became interested in comparative neuroanatomy, and I'll get back to that in 2 seconds, I knew zero about it. I had to start from the beginning. I had to go back to the origins, go back to the original papers, and educate myself from the start. So I don't think I had many of the biases that people tend to have when they get a formal education, and that's for a number of reasons. I can talk to you more about that later, but I had to do it myself, and that makes it hard on one hand, but it comes with a number of bonuses on the other hand. So, compared to her anatomy, how come? Well, it turned out that I was reading into the possibilities. How could it be the case? How could somebody think that we only use 10% of the brain? We know it's not 10% of the mass, it's you use the whole brain. So just to make sure that we use 100% of the brain the whole time, right? It's just that we use it differently. It works differently at any given moment in time. So 100% of the brain. But one of the possibilities was that open any textbook and you would very easily come across the statement that the human brain has 100 billion neurons and 10 times as many glial cells. 100 billion neurons, 10 times as many cells. You do the math, you have roughly 10% of the cells in the human brain are supposedly neurons. So maybe you only used 10% of your brain cells. Next question. Where did that number come from? How do we know that it's 100 billion neurons and 10 times as many glial cells? So that was when I went to the literature. And let me put things into context to you. This is what the literature was about, the literature that mentioned numbers of neurons. This was what it covered, and this is what turned out to be my big favorite subject for the last 15 years, and it remains to be the case. Diversity, in one word. You have all these brains, from very tiny to very, very large, the size of my forearm. And yet, you can recognize some theme going on here. You can always tell that these, or no matter small, medium, or large, they always look like bigger or smaller versions of the same. And if in evolutionary context, we know that the first ones were very small. So the generation of diversity in mammalian evolution, brain diversity in mammalian evolution, must have had a lot to do with how brains get bigger, what happens as brains get bigger, what is it that makes brains become bigger. And the key player here is, of course, the cerebral cortex, the biggest part of the cortex. It starts at about 40% or so in the brain of a very small mammal. It goes up to 80-something percent in the largest brains. So a number of these papers were related with just cataloging this diversity, measuring it, seeing if any patterns came out. So just to walk you through some of the variables here, you can use to describe diversity. This is a coronal section through the brain of a giraffe, through one hemisphere. And you see there's in blue here, you have the contour of the surface, the peel surface of the gray matter. So do that over all sections of the brain, and you have the total surface area of the cortex. Then here you have in yellow, you have the exposed surface area of the cortex. And you see that is much smaller than the total surface area. That means that this cortex is folded. And you can express the degree of folding by just the ratio between the total surface area and the exposed surface area, right? Each cortex, each individual, but also each species can be described by one folding index for that cortex. Now, then you also have the volume of the white matter. You have the volume of the gray matter. That volume of the gray matter divided by the total surface area of the gray matter gives you the average thickness of a cortex. So you can look at how that varies across species. And you have this whole thing composed of neurons and glial cells. And of course, the ever-forgotten endothelial cells that make up the capillaries. I am still not going to talk about them today, but at least you remember they exist. So these are the variables that describe the morphology of the cortex. Now, of course, you would hope to be able to understand how this overall morphology stems from changes in what this cortex is made of, hence its cells. How many glial cells, how many neuronal cells make up a cortex, and how does that vary? Are there patterns? Are there restrictions, let's say, that indicate that there are constraints or rules? Is there ever something that never ever changes that indicates that there are really some absolute constraints in either biology or the physics of how these are put together? All right. Now, as to finding out how many neurons or glial cells compose these rings, a lot of the original literature, essentially everything actually in the original literature, came from studies done by counting cells in thin sections of tissue under the microscope. So you had a certain, you cut the tissue at a certain thickness, you put it under the scope, you measure a certain surface area, or more like a perimeter of the cortex in that section, and you count how many neurons you have underneath that section, right? Multiply that by the thickness of the tissue, and you have some approximation of the volume that you're counting. And if you know how many neurons you found in that volume, divide that by the density, by divide the number of neurons by the volume, and you have the density of neurons in that tissue, right? So you had things like this. This is a review paper from 1987, one of the main sources of data for the longest time, where each data point here is one species, and here you see how the density of a neuron varies as the size of the brain increases, right? So they're scattered, but there's a pattern that had been pointed out already in the 50s that the larger the brain is, the lower the density of neurons. And on the other hand, if you looked at the density of glial cells, what little data was available just pointed to some scatter with no clear systematic variation. So if you consider that there's nothing particular going on here, and essentially what you have is the density of neurons decreasing, you can just say, well, bigger brains are made of larger neurons, and most likely bigger neurons too. If you then use these densities to extrapolate to the entire volume of the brain, you find that yes, there are more neurons in larger brains, and they also tend to be larger. So there you had it. For the longest time, that was deemed good enough. Larger brains are made of more and larger neurons. Makes sense, right? Neurons have to become larger as brains increase because, well, axons have to extend and they are part of neurons. So even for that, at the very least, you would have larger neurons already. With larger neurons would come more glial cells to each neuron. Well, originally the idea, and this was worked by Reinhard Friede here in 1954, what he had originally noticed was that amongst these species here, for every neuron, there seemed to be an increasing number of glial cells across these species, which he understandably considered at the time to have to do with some sort of, what was the word he used exactly? It was like a progressive development, meaning evolution in the progressive sense. And so humans have the most glial cells per neuron, which he thought, well, these are the cells that help the neurons process information, so maybe there you have it. It's something that sets humans apart, or neurons have many glial cells to help them process information. But then these gentlemen noticed that the largest brain that Friede had examined was a human brain, and there are still bigger brains out there. So they got some whale specimens, looked at the cortex, and they realized that, well, no, the ratio of glial cells per every neuron is 4.5. That's much more than the 1.8 that you find in the human cortex. So no, maybe this is just a matter of size. The more the neurons you have, and notice here the assumption is that the whale has more neurons than the human, the larger they are, and the larger the neurons are, the more the glial cells that are probably required to support them. Footnote, how much was known about whether glial cells really are involved in providing metabolic support to neurons in 1957? essentially zero. But it made perfectly good sense. Glial cells were considered support cells. Neurons did all the work. And if you have bigger neurons, they should cost more energy, so they presumably should come with more glial cells, right? It turns out that that is the, so this is what it looks like. The bigger the brain, the larger the glials, the number of glial cells per neuron. So it turns out that a lot of what was known, a lot of what was written in papers and books and textbooks at that time when I got started reading about all this some 15 years ago, was a lot of intuitions based on not a whole lot of data. But it was fine because the intuitions made a lot of sense. For example, let me just go on a little bit further. 57 also, Vernon Mountcastle had described that the cortex has a modular structure. You have these radial columns of cells, or the radial modules, where if you insert an electrode down one of these columns, you find cells with similar properties. But if you make it transverse across the columns, and you go through a succession of different characteristics. So there was this idea that the cortex is made of modules 60 years ago already. And later on, with another one of these studies where you just take a surface area, count how many neurons you have there, and then get your density, these people working in the UK, they found, if you look at the numbers here, it's just, all of them were essentially 100-something neurons underneath 30 microns of the peel surface of the cortex, right? That looks quite impressive in how constant it does seem, except for the visual cortex in monkey and here they knew that they were looking at visual cortex, and here the densities are twice as much. But leave that aside, what you have here is a sample of species, and it looks like the number of neurons underneath a unit surface area of the cortex, so perhaps the number of neurons, then just make a small extrapolation, perhaps the number of neurons in a cortical column is very much the same, right? If you put that together with the notion that there is 10,000-fold variation across all these mammalian species in the surface area of the cortex, but only about a 6-fold variation in thickness, you get the idea that essentially what's varying here from one cortex to the next is surface area, and therefore how many of those columns you had, right? How many of those radial modules you had. And because working on the idea that all the cells in the cortex were generated from a founder population of stem cells that initially divide symmetrically, giving rise to more progenitors, to more undifferentiated progenitors. And at some point, they start undergoing asymmetric divisions that now give rise to another replicating cell, and now one neuron that just goes up and starts forming those columns. You have the radial unit hypothesis, formulated by Pascal Rakish in 1988, that considers that the posits really that the cortex grows in evolution, so you have the generation of diversity in the size of the cortex, essentially through the lateral addition of vertical modules. The cortex grows sideways, and it grows sideways through the expansion of the progenitor cell population. So the more the progenitors that you have early in cortical development that will then give rise to columns, the more columns you have, and therefore the more neurons you have in a larger cortex, right? So it all makes sense. Larger brains have larger cortices. Larger cortices are made of more and larger neurons, accompanied by larger and larger proportions of glial cells to each neuron. And you could go even further and say, well, there's a constant number of neurons per surface area, which means that there must be a universal relationship between the cortical surface area and the number of neurons, right? If the cortex grows laterally as it gains modules, then the surface area of the cortex should be proportional to its number of neurons, and vice versa. The cortical thickness seemed to also scale universally, but very, very slowly with the number of neurons. So here you have the product of these two things is also supposedly a universal, slowly scaling relationship. And there was the added step here that because it had been noticed by several people already in the late 20th century, that larger brains seem to be more folded. There's more and more of that cortical surface area hidden underneath the folds. The idea, which again made very good sense, was that, well, if the cortex expands laterally as it gains modules, as it gains neurons, then it must be this neural expansion that makes the surface grow much faster than the volume, and therefore it folds. As you gain more neurons, the cortex folds. It's interesting that some people would look at the same thing and phrase it the other way around. And as in, the only way for the cortex to gain so many neurons is for the surface to increase much faster than the volume of the cortex, right? So therefore, folding is necessary to allow for more neurons to fit in the cortex. Either way, you can predict that there's a universal relationship between the, how folded a cortex is and how many neurons it has, right? So this is essentially, these are the predictions that you could make from all those, from the consensus really, of how people thought that cortices were made of. Now, let me just recap here. So what we have so far is that we know how cortices get bigger. It's through the expansion of the progenitor cell population. We know what happens next. The number of neurons per module is constant. We know that what happens after that is that you have a cortex that folds more the neurons it's made of, right? The implications here are that if all brains are built the same way, then whoever has the largest cortex should also have the most neurons. And this is where things got weird, because we're nowhere close to having the largest brain or the largest cortex of any being, which is why in the 70s, things seemed to be settled when Harry Jerison realized that for the mass of a generic mammalian body, we humans seem to have the largest brain. So we are the most encephalized species, right? So there you had a consensus. That's a very brief summary of what things were like when I started, when I first got interested in these issues. But what I realized from reading the original literature for the first time, because I knew nothing about any of this, was that, wait a minute, we don't actually know what brains are made of. But everybody seems to be writing these papers on fancy things like intermediate progenitor cell populations and how they expand the surface area of the cortex and how that therefore leads to folding and all these different things, based on what seem to be perfectly good intuitions. They make sense. But what if it's just wrong? What if all brains are actually not made the same way? What if the relationship between how large a cortex is and how many neurons it has is not a single universal relationship? Animals are different. When you get a training in biology, you learn to be sensitive to that. As just as you can look at a species and say, this is a carnivore, this is a rodent, why not there accept the notion that maybe their brains are also made differently? So that was when I realized that we actually didn't know the first thing about how brains really were made of. And nobody seemed to be interested anymore, really, because apparently everybody thought that everybody else already knew. Especially when you open a textbook and you find written there in nice big bold letters, the human brain is made of 100 billion neurons and 10 times as many glial cells. Next question.